Thanks for joining us today to talk about a project that's been ongoing for a couple of years now, and we're at a critical phase, which is to share it with all of you. And so we're talking about crisis standards of care. We'll get into the details of what that actually is. What does it look like? How does it relate to you as hospital and healthcare system folks? So we'll do some other intros here in a minute, but we just want to do some setting of the stage. And so we're going to be talking later on in our presentation at a decent level of depth about some different scenarios. So obviously right in the title of our presentation is the word crisis. And so we need to really expand our view out a ways to the real worst case scenario type thinking. Last year at this meeting, I did a more generic session that provided an overview of the recent changes to CMS and Joint Commission standards for emergency preparedness and emergency management. This time we're going a bit further down the rabbit hole, and this is going to be looking at specifically really intense, high impact type of disaster events that would limit our abilities to provide services as we would normally strive to do. So one example might be a pandemic, right? And so regardless of what the infectious disease driver is, flu being one of our most common concerns, something that really just puts the ultimate squeeze on the healthcare delivery system across the board. So start thinking about what does that look like? You all have some type of pandemic plan as part of your overall comprehensive emergency operations plans, but we're going to get down to that level of detail as we go through. Catastrophic flooding. Now, long ago when Vermont hospitals were built, they were all built in relatively good locations. Most of us are not prone to true flash flooding or inundation flooding, but some of those maps are changing. Some of those old land reliability patterns are changing due to things like climate change, drivers of extreme weather events. But catastrophic flooding can and does happen in our communities. And it can be at a level and to an extent that can really disrupt operations across the board for any part of the healthcare system. So these are two examples of things that taken at their extremes might drive us towards this alternate mode of operation, these crisis standards that we're going to look at. So our goals for today's session is going to help you define crisis standards of care as a concept. We're going to talk a lot about it being a flexible framework. We're going to keep coming back on that. We'll give you an overview of the purpose and scope and sort of the highlight reel of a newly minted plan that really is a living document. It really truly is in draft form. We'll unpack as much of that as we can and then talk about guidance for providers, for administrators, and really the next steps for where we want to see this project and plan go as we proceed, and then have some more resources as we go ahead. So again, Mike Lyden, Emergency Management Director at Porter Medical Center. I'm going to let my other panelists introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Dr. Ryan Sexton, Medical Director of the Emergency Department at NVRH. I'm President of the Med Staff there. I serve as Medical Advisor to District 5 EMS. I'm on the Advisory Committee for the Northeastern Medical Reserve Corps. I have a background in emergency medicine. I also completed a fellowship in disaster and EMS. And I'm board certified in both emergency medicine and EMS services. And I'm sick today with bronchitis, but I'm very happy to be here trying to talk to you today. With that, I'll let David speak.
Good morning. My name is David Casey. I'm not as ill as Dr. Sexton, fortunately. I work at the Vermont Department of Health, and I'm a public health program administrator there. And I've been on the workgroup for the crisis standards of care plan development for the past 18 months, 2 years, and I'm a nurse and have background in acute care nursing.
Great, thank you guys. So no disclosures in particular for us as your panelists. We do want to attribute some credit to an organization that was a contractor working for the Department of Health to help drive this project forward called All Clear Emergency Management. So we've used some of their content, and we'll come back to that a little bit later as well. So let's get right down to defining the concept of what these crisis standards of care are really all about. And this is going to be something we touch on repeatedly to really drive home for you some of the takeaway messages. So the overall goal of this initiative, and we're going to talk about the history here in a moment of it, is to develop a framework which includes tools for altering what we would regard as our normal day-to-day standard of care, the sort of parameters under which we render care with targeted improvements in mind, endpoints, quality benchmarks, whatever it may be. And if we have to modify those standards, we'd like to at least have a framework to guide us in what are potentially very high consequence decision-making scenarios with an incomplete set of information, because that's sort of the backbone of any time you're operating in a disaster or a crisis mode. You, many of you as administrators, are going to be in position to be making decisions with incomplete picture, incomplete resources. Not everything is going to be easy. And so this overarching project began a couple years ago to build out this framework for consistent and equitable resource allocation. Another key aspect of this is that the planning endeavor itself is really valuable in the context of having a flexible framework, especially when we touch on things like equity and fairness and proportionality. There are other types of plans that you have within your organizations, your kind of classical emergency operations plans, that are very granular and sort of a how-to checklist. So somewhere in your organizational emergency operations plan is that section about where's your hospital command center going to be? And I'll be slightly hospital biased, but it's really any organization, right, in the health sector. Where's your command center going to be? What equipment is going to be in that command center? Who's going to staff it? In what roles? Where would you get your backup fuel for your generator as your tanks drain down during a multi-day power outage? All of that granular detail is very sort of check, 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 algorithm based. This is going to feel a bit more fuzzy because it's as much a philosophical framework as it is a sort of granular how-to plan. So that's another important thing to think about as we kind of frame through it. Also looking at, you know, maximizing self-care through public messaging. There's a robust public engagement piece to this, both during the planning phase, but also if the health sector were ever to get to the point of needing to implement these crisis principles, we need to be reaching out and communicating with the public. There are legal framework components to this we'll touch on, and it's about trying to protect the integrity of the health system and work on resiliency and recovery, right? Bouncing back the pieces and parts as quickly as possible, trying to get back to that normal standard of care as quickly as possible. But we may have to dip below the line of normalcy. So going back a bit, going back 10 years really, to the last sort of brush we had as a healthcare system in the United States with pandemic flu, in 2009, there was preliminary work done on this topic. And other states had been kind of chipping away at it going back 10 or more years, but not many had really wrapped their heads around it. Nothing like a pandemic to help kind of nudge that up a little bit. And so people got closer to that goal of, hey, how do we really make these fallback contingency plans for if we really get into the trouble zones in terms of eroding our ability to provide quality care across the board? So the pandemic model, again, overwhelming demands on the healthcare system. There simply won't be enough space, resources, staff, medications for everybody. So what's an equitable framework to do the greatest good for the greatest number? That's a big underpinning here. So in Vermont, that group did get a little bit of momentum. And then as the pandemic kind of transitioned off and we kind of went back to our normal operations, it just sort of ended up on the wayside. Just wasn't on the relative priority list. When we confronted things like the possibility of Ebola transmission in the United States and in Vermont, right? We were doing longitudinal monitoring. Before I ended up at Porter, I was at the State Health Department. We were doing monitoring of individuals coming back from West Africa. A lot of you recall this. You know, we didn't ever envision that going to this place. We had to marshal new resources, come up with new plans and some related contingencies, but it never took us to this same place of the healthcare system being at the point of collapse. So, jump ahead, 2017, probably mid-year, I think it was in 2017, the health department decided to reprioritize this particular initiative. And as kind of the lead public health agency, it was a natural place to start this process. And so the health department, with David serving in a project manager capacity, launched an initiative to try to build out a draft crisis standard of care plan and framework. So there's a work group. I was on that work group as well, representing the Vermont Healthcare Emergency Preparedness Coalition. It's a sort of entity made up of emergency management and emergency preparedness folks from Vermont healthcare organizations that comes together and works on topics like these and others related to preparedness. Meetings were held over the 18-month period, 13 meetings or so, a lot of virtual back and forth. again, they used a contractor to drive that process. And the contractor came to us with sort of national level experience. They'd done similar work with coalitions in states in Colorado and other places. They were able to scan the literature, scan what resources are out there, trial and error. Again, the notion that this is experiential in the planning process, and that's where a lot of the intrinsic value is because, thankfully, there aren't a lot of occasions to battle test these kinds of things, at least in the sort of continental US, right? And so these kinds of issues are hard to sort of really probe and work on in a meaningful way. Again, there's a vision for continuing this process we'll get to here. So small print, but there's a snapshot of the organizations. So you had hospital representation, public health representation, both state and the sort of local level, the local offices. VAS had a seat on it, Pharmacists Association, Board of Medical Practice, primary care organization, disability rights, Vermont Ethics Network. You get the idea here. Cast a wide net, got lots of stakeholder input and review. Quite a bit of, I guess you would almost say, dynamic tension among some of these organizations. They don't all see the world through the same healthcare lens, and that's the whole point. And so having the right people at the table to tussle over some of these issues was really fruitful. So we touched on a couple of these, but there has been this national movement. It's been on the national priority list to do for jurisdictions, states principally, but sometimes it's at a smaller level. But this is a big movement towards thinking through what real fallback positions might look like, real contingency plans might look like. And it was interesting to hear back from our keynote the sort of 10-year plus history of the Affordable Care Act. And you remember back even to Hillary Clinton's initial efforts when she was first lady, all of the hue and cry around, you know, death panels and rationing of resources and people are not going to get care they need. This stuff actually does kind of take us to that place intentionally and tries to do it in a thoughtful way ahead of time so that when we're really in it, your hospital's been reduced to a 6-bed tent in the parking lot because the rest of it is destroyed or inoperable or contaminated by who knows what. We've had a little bit of thought going into it. So again, framework and tools for altering normal patient care, maybe altering staffing, maybe altering equipment standards, chipping away at what we would recognize as normal modern healthcare delivery, and making treatment decisions. So Dr. Sexton will talk specifically through that lens of a frontline healthcare provider, what it might look and feel like to make these kind of arbiter type decisions. And again, the goal is here, maximizing patient survival, minimize adverse outcomes. If we're in the true crisis state of affairs, the backdrop needs to be, mentally, that there will be issues with patient survival, issues with reducing and managing morbidity and mortality. People will die, regardless of your efforts. There will be excess morbidity and mortality that does not match your normal way of doing business, which is a lot to really wrap your head around, whether you're an administrator or a provider or, you know, part of the overall healthcare team. So again, framework, you're getting the theme here. We're really kind of pitching this to you pretty repeatedly to get to that place of understanding what it is and what it isn't. It's not going to be a how-to cookbook method of keeping people alive during a disaster. It's got to be a little more flexible than that. When the volume of patients and their needs surpasses all available capabilities and capacity of the healthcare providers and or facilities for using their normal standards and operating practices and procedures, it will constitute a failure of care. It's a little more on a spectrum than just sort of a hard, okay, we failed. It's a little bit of a spectrum and a continuum you'd be going through. But we're at a point where drastic changes would need to be done to provide any care. So when I do new employee orientation spiels about emergency preparedness, I did one on Monday, often all of that, you know, 200-page emergency operations guidance and plans comes down to continuity of operations, right? So it's all about keeping the doors open, the lights on, people being taken care of. That's what a lot of it really boils down to. And here we're running into circumstances that really fundamentally challenge our ability to do that. All of Vermont hospitals, again, being slightly hospital biased, you know, roughly 40 to 50 minutes apart, depending on which part of the state we're talking about. Diversion, the idea of diversion, hey, we're totally full, hey, we're incapacitated, hey, our emergency department's closed, almost never done in our state. Right? It's just not really feasible in a rural state where our healthcare system's a web of this particular construct. But having to get to that point where failure is occurring, what are we really going to do? Can we do anything to stay open and keep doing the work? So an important disclaimer here, this framework is not a substitute for your organization's core emergency operations plan. You have to have a robust emergency preparedness, emergency management program to even begin to conceptualize how you might deal with these worst case scenario things, where you're talking about failure of the care delivery systems. So CMS says you have to have it, pretty much all healthcare disciplines. Joint Commission, it's got a whole big expansive set of standards on it. So you're gonna have a program, and now we need to get to another level of sophistication and figure out how this dovetails into your existing emergency preparedness, emergency management programs. We have continuity of operations plans. That was a big part that came out of the CMS update a couple years ago. They want to see that you've thought through and connected the dots to sustain your operations in the face of many types of disasters. Your continuity of operations plan is really close to failing when we're switching over to crisis mode, right? We're not able to do the care we would like to do. But you should do everything up to that point. You should have plans that back up all of that. All of your generator supplies, your caches of food, your models of communicating with your staff to call them in, send them home, keep them overnight if that's what's required. All those other granular pieces and parts that let you be a resilient organization. Another sort of caveat with our crisis standards of care framework, and Dr. Sexton is going to talk a little bit about the difference between contingency versus crisis. When we're talking about crisis standards, point of failure in the healthcare system, we are almost always, and this is based on past experiences in the United States, talking about a governor-level declared emergency. So our governor has great authority, all governors do, to declare an emergency in the entire state or part of the state, backed up by the Commissioner of Health, so the state commissioner of the health department. That declaration really, from the executive branch, fundamentally changes the legal landscape a bit. And we'll touch on that again, but just recognize that that's often the backdrop for this. So this is not just a bad day in the healthcare system. This is a major event in Vermont, likely unprecedented. So we had our massive flooding event in 1927. We had Irene in 2011. This is kind of the next massive statewide kind of impact, or a good portion of the state. One gear in a complex machine, we've touched on this, your emergency operations plan, and it's part of an overall system-wide response. So we've got robust state and local systems, although in Vermont, honestly, a lot of what we talk about for emergency response systems are at that state level. State emergency management, state health department doing the public health side of things, our state hospital association potentially being involved as well. We also have health systems, healthcare delivery systems and networks. So there's another sort of substructure there. And this crisis standards framework fits into that overall gear set. It's also a layer cake in terms of resources. Some of the legality gets tangled up too, but it's really, think of it as a layer cake in terms of local, state, and federal. So at the local level, which is most of us, right, where we're kind of living, working, and operating our healthcare organizations, continuity of operations and business continuity is gonna be the theme here in these crisis situations. We're doing our very best to keep the doors open, lights on, people being taken care of. We are likely to promulgate resource needs. We will run into gaps. We do not have enough XYZs, ventilators, pharmaceuticals, regular old normal saline, right? Things that we know are prone to shortages already. We will then have to send those resource requests out there into the world and hope somebody can match with us. If they can't match with us, what do we do? How do we cross that particular bridge? We also provide situational information, situational awareness. We tell others what's happening to us. Again, we have to have somewhere else a big emergency management plan that tells us how to do that. What's your fallback if your phone system goes down? Most of you use a VoIP-style phone system and we lose internet connectivity. Do you have copper landlines? How many of them? Do you have satellite phones? How many cell phones do you have in the organization? All of those pieces to connect. The next layer up would be the state level. And when we get to this point, really, our state has actually got a pretty sensitive trigger, which I appreciate, for activating their systems, because we don't have county government in Vermont. So we tend to bump up pretty quickly to that state level, which is great. It brings to bear more resources and structure. All of this, again, we're using the incident command system and something called NIMS, National Incident Management System. The state's trying to build a common operating picture. What's happening across the health sector? who needs help, who needs what resources, can we match? Are we as a system statewide approaching that breaking point? How are the neighbors doing in New York and New Hampshire and Massachusetts? Trying to stitch it all together, and then they tap into the federal level as well. State's gonna provide us that disaster declaration. Federal government, supplemental resources, none of them live in Vermont, those resources. They're not standing by to be deployed. We have two portable hospitals in our state that are inflatable. They don't come with staff. They come with sort of basic materiel. So we've got a little layer in there, but when we're talking about things like federal disaster medical assistance teams or the mortuary equivalent, those things can be obtained, but they take time. And again, think about a pandemic. There's not gonna be a pandemic in just Vermont, right? There's gonna be a pandemic in the United States, in Eastern Canada, Eastern North America. So all the resources are gonna get it from all sides. There's also the regulatory waiver piece, which is sort of a joint state and federal item. Your plans right now, your emergency management plan, should address this notion of an 1135 waiver. Who's heard of an 1135? Does that ring any bells? So an 1135 waiver is something you would petition the federal government to do, either through your state channels or you can even go straight to the feds, to essentially absolve you of many of the standard CMS regulations and parameters, from finance to patient safety, the whole thing across the board. And so you should have a little blurb in your plans, I know CMS looks for it when they come around these days, about requesting an 1135 waiver. That'll fundamentally sort of be part of modifying this stage on which we're rendering care. So I'm gonna hand it over to Dr. Sexton to talk about utilization of the plan. I'm just gonna switch our mics here.
So again, for those of you that came in a little bit later, my name's Dr. Ryan Sexton. We are a panel here today, and the way that we thought would be best to do this would be to present on items that we felt most comfortable with from our backgrounds. We were all in the work group developing this crisis standard of care. And then have a lot of time at the end. This is an interactive session, we want it to be. So for question answer at the end. But certainly during this, if you have a question that's burning, raise your hand and talk about it. I do like to just get a feel for audience. So how many administrators? I assume a good amount. How many frontline staff? One, okay. Nurse, physician, yeah, great. How many emergency management specialists? Not many, okay, great. So thank you, Mike, for giving the great introduction here. And I'll just add, you know, why do we care about this? Why are you guys here? I can tell why I care about it. So I'm frontline, I'm an emergency physician, and I have no idea what an 1135 waiver is. None, okay? I didn't know about it, frankly, until I did my fellowship in disaster management. So 4 years of med school, 3 years of residency, 2 years of a fellowship, and at the end of it, I'm studying for boards, and I learned about 1135 waiver. So we've been fortunate here recently that we haven't had a major disaster, but that just means that one's coming. So we always kind of think about that. I don't think it's not the best approach to say, well, it's not going to happen, or it hasn't happened recently. I think the better approach would be to say, hey, Minnesota has spent a lot of time working on this, and they've done a great job, and we'll pull up some of Minnesota's work. We used it as part of our crisis standard of care. And there's national recommendations on this, and we should probably do it. And oh, Vermont's just a small state, we don't need this. I look at it more like Vermont's a small state and we have an opportunity here to do it well and coordinate it through our hospitals. I will also say that when the fecal matter hits the fan, I'm a frontline emergency physician, and I'm gonna depend on the administrators and the emergency management specialist to give me this framework, for the state to support me and what I'm doing with a framework. It's surprising to me that in this day and age, with things that this country has gone through recently, that we don't yet have this kind of mandated and required. I'm so happy that the state of Vermont has jumped on this and that you all are here to learn about it today. There is still work to be done, and we'll talk about that toward the end of our talk today. So, you know, if I were to ask, and I have my very well-trained, board-certified emergency colleague who works at our big trauma center here in the state, what is a crisis standard of care? They don't know. Their response would be, I don't know. Does Vermont have one? I don't know. I would argue that the emergency physician that I'm asking is probably the best one of all of our physicians to, they're gonna be the front line here. They do triage day in, day out. It's part of their practice. You know, you ask a surgeon to do a procedure without an overhead light or an ENT to remove a foreign body without their CATS extractor, it's not gonna go well. If you ask an emergency physician to do a procedure without the overhead light because the light burned out, they're gonna ask for a flashlight. So we work with limited resources, we triage, we're the front line, and even the specialists in the field don't have a good grasp on this. So I would argue that there is a good need for administrators to embrace this, to know it, to help us and provide us with the guidance and framework that we're gonna need when things get tough. So in terms of utilization of the plan, and I wanna point out some things, these are from the plan. This plan is intended specifically when we have patients who are gonna perish if they don't receive resources. And further, that they're likely to survive if we are able to coordinate resources. Now this isn't everybody, because in a disaster situation, we're gonna do the greatest good for the greatest number. Unfortunately, some will perish, but if we can coordinate efforts and get resources to patients, they could survive. The other thing that I'll note is this plan is only, as Mike mentioned, to be implemented during a declared state of emergency. So without that declaration, you know, there's aspects of this plan that we can use on a local level that we can kind of refer to, but it doesn't actually go into effect until we have that declaration. Critical to that is an understanding that something's going on, which I think there's work to be done in this state on that. Having an understanding that five of our hospitals are completely full, and two of them are on diversion, you know, making sure that we have those triggers, and I'll talk about some triggers here in a second. We've got some work to do in the state on that. Because if we don't know that something's going on, we can't act. So possible situations where we may utilize this plan. Mike mentioned saline shortage. We had that a couple years ago. We could not get saline. So, you know, any sort of supply shortage, critical supply shortage, could require that we utilize a crisis standard of care plan. So maybe for some reason, the blood bank, regional blood bank, all blood is contaminated, you know, for whatever reason, and we're not going to get blood for the next week, right? We have no supply. That's a major issue, right? We're not going to be able to treat trauma as we would on a day-to-day basis, and so that may be a reason to institute a crisis standard of care. Another, and this is the more common, the one that we think about, is an epidemic affecting our region, or a pandemic affecting, you know, multiple regions, you know, around the world. This is real. You know, we had Ebola scare recently. That's still ongoing. We constantly worry about our flu pandemic and when the next bad one is going to come. This has the real potential. It's probably the highest threat in my mind to emergency care and standard care. Is when we get the next big pandemic. Hopefully it's not today. I've had this for a week or so. But no kidding aside, this is a, you know, it's a scary thing that, you know, we may be faced with staff who are sick that can't come in. Staff families. You know, how can you expect your staff to come in when their kids are sick at home and everyone's sick? So staff shortage is there. It's a really bad flu requiring, when people get sick, that they're ventilated. They're on a mechanical ventilation. Well, we only have a certain number of vents. And we've gone beyond asking, you know, New Hampshire for some vents or New York State for some additional vents, because they're going through the same thing. So what do we do there? As an emergency physician, again, we're really good at triaging resources and time and care. but we still have this expectation on our day-to-day that we're going to do everything we possibly can for each patient. This sort of framework and what is required is that we move away from that sort of ethic to an ethic that is more utilitarian. And having guidance, having one big question always come up is, am I protected? Am I legally protected? What am I going to do? This patient needs a vent and I can't give it to him. A big question that comes up is, when do we trigger this? And this is some good examples. And this separates here conventional, contingency, and crisis. This is from the plan. We kind of, this looks a little bit prettier, so I like it set up this way better. Conventional is what we do day to day. So usual care, normal staffing, normal resources. Contingency is when we start to get a little bit taxed. So maybe we have, instead of our typical 2 to 3 patients presenting per hour to the emergency department, all of a sudden we're seeing 10 patients an hour for a few hours. Or we've run out of blood and we need to get blood from somewhere else. Hospitals may even go on diversion status. I work at a small critical access hospital. I've got 9 beds in my emergency department. And if all of a sudden we get a major mass casualty event where a tent falls on a whole crowd of people, which happened not too long ago across the border, we're going to see a ton of an influx of patients, and we may not be able to care or provide our conventional standard to patients. So we would move into a contingency here. Again, still with the ethic of doing all that we possibly can for each individual patient, but we may have to modify how we're doing things a little bit. Versus now we're moving into crisis. And I would argue that as we're in contingency, we should start to raise some flags, right? We should start waving our hands a little bit, saying, hey, and the plan calls for this, that we alert the state, that people understand what we're individually going through. And now we're in crisis. This is where we actually have to change our standards. I would call it it is an altered standard of care, but I would argue that it's a situation-specific standard of care for a crisis situation. So there is a website here. If you want to Google as well, you can Google Vermont crisis standard of care, and I would just add the word all, or two words, all clear after it, and that will bring it up. There's a link to it, but you can write this down as well. To take a look at it. These are the table of contents. The plan is 89 pages, so we're not going to go through the majority of it here today. We do have a few copies if anyone's interested in seeing it. But David's going to talk about what we expect and what we hope going forward with this draft. But in terms of aspects, you have your scope of the plan. There's some definitions. It certainly goes into statewide response and operations. It does get into legal issues as well. There's aspects of, like Mike talked about, the 1135 waiver. These are critical aspects that we all need to be familiar with. There's some ethical guidelines and values that hopefully as a framework we can fall back on. One thing that we didn't want this plan to do was to give us exact treatment decisions. Every situation is going to be slightly different. It's going to require your frontline staff to make difficult decisions. And what the frontline staff, they didn't ask for, tell me exactly how to decide who gets a vent and who does it. But what they do request and require is some framework to fall back on. This provides, there's specific ethical guidelines that we talk about in the crisis standard of care that we can fall back on. So another way to think about it is moving from your standard care to a sufficient care. We need to do all that we can with the resources we have. And so we've got a huge demand limited resources, we're in this crisis state. What are some things that we can think about and should be thinking about? And there's a lot. We talked about the waivers. You know, waivers including waiver to allow us to open up an alternate care site. Alternate care site, details of how we're going to do that. A lot of these things would have to be included in our hospital emergency management plans. You know, versus how are we going to expand palliative and hospice care? Okay, we're not going to provide our standard treatment to everybody, but they're in a lot of pain. We should treat that pain. How do we do that ethically, morally? How do we support our providers to make those difficult decisions? Expanded scope of practice is another interesting one. I also serve on the Vermont Board of Medical Practice, and you know, there's legal issues, there's scope of practice issues. These things need to be considered. You know, they are addressed here again as a framework. It is an area where I feel like we could do a little bit more with this draft. So, you know, ultimately, you know, and these are things that we may have to do as part of a sufficiency model crisis standard of care. You know, this falls back on, we're going to try to do the best that we can with what we got. And that's a utilitarian ethic. Greatest good for the greatest number, given the resources we have available. I'm going to stop there. Again, we're going to have a lot of time for question and answers, but I want to give David the opportunity to come up.
Thank you. So the question is, now that you're here, now that you know about the plan, so what? And I'm here to tell you. The next steps that we have involve, you know, right now there are 34 people from the work group who have a pretty good understanding of the plan. That does not a plan make, and it would be impossible to implement a plan if there are only 34 people in the state of Vermont that has 650,000 people. You know, we wouldn't be able to do anything unless you all know about it, unless all Vermonters know something about it. So our next steps for the plan are to educate people and to ask for feedback. As Michael mentioned, you all have a lot of plans of your own. You have emergency management or emergency operations plans and procedures. Do your procedures dovetail with the new statewide Vermont Crisis Standards of Care plan? Do they align with one another? Do they correlate with one another? We want to know that because, as you are aware, with plan development and plan management, there's always that process of continuous improvement and continuous review. We've made a plan. That's just the start of the process. You know, we need to keep improving it. And we've created a draft over the past 2 years. Now comes the hard part of making sure that the plan pairs with reality, making sure that the plan works with your plans, and making sure that you know about the plan and are able to refer to it in a time of need. Now, of course, this plan is a plan that, by the grace of God, hopefully we will never need, and hopefully you will never need to activate. That, as Dr. Sexton pointed out, you know, the next disaster is can be just around the corner. I'll also point out, or just observe, that 2005, Hurricane Katrina, Memorial Hospital. Has anyone read 5 Days at Memorial? In a way, that this is what this is all about. This is the crisis standards of care planning nationwide. Really, kind of got the kick in the pants up following Hurricane Katrina and the very, very unfortunate situations that occurred at Memorial Hospital in New Orleans. And, you know, sad to say, that was not an isolated incident. We, you know, I think the argument can be made that we have not necessarily learned the lessons of that disaster.
Hurricane Sandy and some of the hospitals in Long Island and so forth kind of had a repeat of that many years later. So, and our next Irene is one day it'll happen. So we do want to bear in mind that while we don't want to use this plan, the likelihood of it being used is probably somewhat limited, but we sure want to have it in our back pocket, ready to use, and be aware of it when we need to. So two things. Understanding the plan, getting feedback on it so that we can improve it and have it really work for all Vermonters is important. We also want to involve you in enabling, supporting you to be able to embellish your own sort of disaster plans so that whatever you've got going on, you can really maximize your resources and maximize your ability to respond. Dr. Sexton talked about, and Michael talked about, these pandemic influenza type events. I mean, one of the things that I think keep many of us awake at night is what happens when our staff just are not able to show up to work. And you can't operate a hospital without people. And people who work at hospitals are normal people. We have families, we have homes that we need to protect, we have pets that we need to feed, and how do we juggle all of this and yet provide care? These are all things that are important to think about and resources that we need to think about managing, before the event. Management of resources really involves management, first of all, of local resources. It's been said that all disasters are local, like politics. And, our resources right down the road in our own communities, in our own backyards, are far more accessible. We know about them, far more friendly to us than the resources that happen to be available in New Jersey or Maine or Massachusetts or whatever. If we're reaching out to Massachusetts, we know we have a problem because they're not going to come for, 10 hours, 15 hours, 24 hours. If we call down the street, we know that we can get some resources, within an hour, within minutes, conceivably. Building those partnerships is within our community is one of the big messages that I think should come out of this today. That's something that you can do now. When you're looking for extra fuel, do you have those memorandums of understanding in place with the local fuel distributor to be able to make sure that you're at the top of the list when your fuel supply is getting low? Are you at the top of the list for oxygen deliveries? Do you have those memorandums in place? And do you have the staffing formulas in place that say, okay, we've got the call tree, sure, but what happens when a third of the call tree is kind of like cut off? What do we do then? In terms of staffing, can we borrow from the local nursing home? Can we borrow from the acute care, the walk-in clinic down the street, the Concentras and so forth? And can Concentras or the acute care clinics borrow from the hospital? And how can we combine and synergize, our resources? So to recap, we continue the education process, soliciting feedback for the development and maintenance and embellishment of our statewide plan, and for you, continuing to develop your plans, your facility plans, and continue to develop your local resources and get those contacts, have them on your speed dials, and know the people at the other end of the line, so that when they need help, you can respond, and when you need help, they can respond. So, did anyone have any questions at this point? That kind of concludes the sort of the main main program here. We have a scenario that we'd like to walk you through, but so far, from what you've heard, I know this is, we've done a kind of a data dump, and it's kind of odd material to begin with, but sure, yeah.
I remember working with Chris Grace, infectious disease at the Medical Center back in 2009, about, you know, contingency planning for the pandemic, and it was a frightening exercise, thinking about turning the Fannie Allen into a respiratory hospital exclusively. Anyway, that's not really my question, but other than the fact that, you know, it's 10 years later, it's interesting to revisit it. My question is about media and spreading the word, and also whether the plan envisions, you know, so much of the crisis might be a little bit mitigated by the general public understanding what's going on as soon as we're getting a sense that something bad is happening. So those memorandums of understanding with WCAX to, you know, start interrupting programming extensively, maybe, to teach the public about the flu, about, you know, the all those contingency plans before things get really, really bad. How does the plan envision pulling the triggers on that before we're in total deep trouble?
That's a great question. And, you know, to paraphrase that or to repeat it for others who may not have heard, the question is, how do we keep people out of the hospital to begin with so that the sick people, the people who really need hospital care are there? And the response to that is in the plan there is a pre-hospital there is some pre-hospital thinking and consideration and so forth, and that's something that is going to require and we have some of that in place already at the state health department level, but hopefully you as well in your local health facilities have relationships with local media. Because they are a key element in providing patient education to make sure that the worried well, as it were, or whatever, are not overwhelming resources that are already overwhelmed, or simply to provide good, non-pharmaceutical interventions. You know, we all know that during flu season and all the time we're implored to wash our hands and cover our coughs and to practice social distancing. These are the kinds of things that can and should be broadcast in the media and can and should be part of and are part of the crisis standards of care plan. But, you know, that's a really critical element, and I'll be honest and say I think that that's another area where further development of this plan can go. We've, I would say to a certain degree, we've focused more on the clinical aspect.
I'll just add to that, David. So I mentioned earlier that the crisis standards framework is one gear, or one cog in a particularly complicated machine. So we need to leverage the other parts of the machine and the system. So to the question about media outreach, we already have within our emergency management framework the ability, the tools, the knowledge, and the methods for engaging media directly. And so, again, we use something called the National Incident Management System and the Incident Command System as part of that. And within that, there's a model for public information dissemination, right? PIOs, public information officers. Each hospital should have one designated. Each healthcare organization should have one designated. You can link public information officers together into something called a joint information system. And so the joint information system ties together the different voices, but gets them onto one message. And so our state, again, we tend to go from local to state level support. Our state entities are rather adept at this. So state emergency management and state health department in their operations center pair up with us to hit that highlight reel of messaging, to mitigate, to take the pressure valve and release some of the flow coming towards us. Self-care, a lot of those pieces are there. Now, if all of our systems are breaking because the disaster is such, it's just going to be that much harder. But the good news is we do have a lot of this sort of foundation level work already done. We just need to leverage it effectively during the crisis. Easier said than done. So it's a good point. The other piece kind of that I was thinking about as we were talking about next steps with David is, of course, how do we get this content we're talking about as healthcare professionals in front of the public ahead of time? How do you take this content and make it digestible and understandable? Wait, when my loved one comes to the hospital and you only have 5 ventilators and 10 people need them and my person is one of the people that needs a ventilator, you're not going to give it to them? How's that going to work? So that's one of our biggest challenges within this planning framework is how do we get this message broken off in the right kind of a chunk to give to the public ahead of time? Pretty darn tricky. So I saw one hand here and then we'll come over.
So to do anything well, you need to practice at it. You also have to keep your shop running because you're 24/7. One of the struggles that I think of when I think about these types of things is what's that right cadence? Knowing that there's expense, right? Getting all those people together to build that muscle and feel confident that when a situation does present itself, you're able to respond with a certain degree of muscle memory that's present. But it's a balance. And I don't know, are there any best practices or recommendations for hospitals or healthcare systems to practice?
Yeah, so the question about exercising and drills, that always comes up when we talk about any kind of plan or structure we've built is we should test and validate it. And in this case, we're less likely to be able to do that against a real scenario. So how do we exercise it given all the other competing demands and priorities? And so that is going to be in the sort of recommendation set that comes with the document and the guidance. And I actually talked to the contractor that was working with us and he was like, you gotta exercise these plans. How do we do that in a meaningful way is a little bit elusive. Tabletop, we're gonna transition here in a second, have a little sort of tabletop thought discussion-based exercise, but it's gonna be hard to envision doing super complicated exercising around this because it's very hard to get to the realism of it, I think. You're gonna have patient actors, all of whom are pretending not to be able to breathe, and you have to pick which one gets a nebulizer treatment. I mean, it doesn't lend itself to easy exercising, certainly, unlike something like hospital evacuation, which we can do on a sort of full-scale basis. So yeah, and disclosure, Tom's from my hospital, and this is a running theme in our hospital, is talking about how to weigh the sort of demands of exercising against the realities of running a facility.
It's a great question. I would add to it that, and I mentioned this, you know, in my education as a physician, we didn't get much about disaster medicine. And so I think there is an opportunity to long-term to think about, you know, could some of this important work be incorporated into medical school education, and that's a great place where you can do drills and scenarios versus residencies where it would be, I think, pertinent as well. Some schools have started to do this, that's one area where I think, you know, we could get some training to individuals, nursing schools as well, prior to it, you know, them entering the employment.
Prioritizing the caregiving interviews, that someone's going to get a life-saving treatment and someone may be denied that life-saving treatment. Has that decision-making rubric been standardized across the state? Or is that something that each hospital has to struggle with? Or is there a standard there? And then thinking of things that happen in New Orleans. For the physicians and other practitioners who are making those decisions, have there been things to protect them legally? Because I know that was an issue in New Orleans as well, where people were held accountable for doing the best they could in those circumstances.
The question is, how do we make decisions? How do we make safe, moral, ethical, effective decisions that we think will lead to the saving the greatest number of lives? That's basically a moral question. It's a lifeboat question. Mike earlier said, you know, we're talking about death panels here, and you know, in the very, very worst scenario, that's pretty much what we got. I think that the plan, you know, we have set up guide rails because what is going to work for a long-term care facility is not going to work for a level one trauma center. What's going to work for a level one trauma center is not going to work for an acute care hospital or a dialysis clinic. It needs to be flexible. It would be wonderful to have a panel of physicians who are not treating the particular patient along with a medical ethicist to be able to sit for 10 minutes and discuss and debate the pros and cons of taking a patient who is currently on a ventilator off a ventilator to give it to somebody else who may be in greater need. You know, the vast majority of hospitals in Vermont do not have those resources. So it needs to be flexible. The best we can do is have some general recommendations concepts that people can follow. You know, not making decisions in isolation, having group decisions be made to the best one possibly can, having transparency, documenting well, consistency. You know, if you're going to have a policy to take a respirator off of XYZ person, apply that consistently. I had a thought regarding what you said, just very quickly. You know, in terms of emergency preparedness and practicing this sort of thing, one of the things that all of us have some experience is actually going to areas during emergency and practicing as providers. That's really great experience. It's not the real thing, but practicing in low resource situations where you really kind of have to make do and think on your feet and so forth, you know, that can be a good thing. And Vermonters are very good about helping out in the rest of the world. I'm sorry, go ahead, Dr.
Yeah, I mean, to your question about legality and liability, I think it's a start of a conversation within this plan, but I don't think it goes as far as creating new statute. It doesn't. And you bring up a good point. I think that we could go a little bit further there as a state. It brings up aspects of Vermont's Good Samaritan law, which requires that you're not compensated for your time, which if we're frontline and we're being paid to be there, we're being compensated, so we're not protected under that necessarily. You know, there's another statute that it brings up, you know, about being an employee of the state that would provide some protection, and it's arguable that in a state declared disaster, we may fall under that potentially. That's an area where I think we could push a little bit further as a state.
That was VSA or 20 VSA subsection 20, it does have a small sentence in there passed in 2005, and interestingly enough, where a person acting in the capacity of emergency response, which I could see as being defined as a physician or nurse in a hospital, their liability is limited. Talk to a lawyer about that, a prosecuting lawyer about that, they'll have a different opinion. So, yes.
So does your plan address, so in a state of emergency, how do you address securing and keeping the staff safe? And in order for them to be able to do their work, as you are telling family members that their loved one can't get a life-saving procedure, and you have probably more folks at your site than the site can probably handle.
So another good question about security of the facility and your staff and sort of almost sheltering in place aspects of it. At Porter, I also oversee our security program, and so that content should be contained within your continuity of operations plan. So there's, again, linking different pieces and parts of your overall emergency management program. So in your continuity of operations plan, there should be a section that addresses, hey, here's how we will secure our facility. Here are the spaces within the hospital or the hotel down the street where we will house our staff. If roads are impassable, we have a MOU for busing, whatever it may be. But yes, security would become a real consideration. Also remember that healthcare organizations, in particular hospitals, in our small Vermont communities tend to be beacons. They may be the only place with power, maybe the only place with telecommunications, often on the priority list for being the first to get restored for services. So people are likely in these large-scale catastrophic disasters to come to you whether you want them or not. So having advanced programs around securing your doors, if you have a security workforce or people that cover that responsibility, traffic control, there's a whole other can of worms that comes with it. So it's a really good point.
The crisis standard plan does not provide as much a roadmap for that. Instead, incorporate by reference your core emergency operations plan. There's a lot to, you know, you can keep tugging at the threads and you can see how it all is kind of a mesh. So, good. Other questions? I think we'll transition now. We'll run you through a quick sort of thought exercise, almost like a small tabletop.
David, can I grab the?
So here it is. We'll run through this. We've got 15 minutes, 16 minutes to solve a catastrophic disaster. So I'm sure we can do that. So tropical storm, right? Still one of our more likely scenarios for a hit. So what we've been talking about today, it's really interesting to note, happens with a far higher degree of regularity outside the continental United States, right? So a lot of what we've been talking through very much occurred on the ground in Puerto Rico. What we've been talking through very much right now is happening in the Bahamas, parts of the Bahamas, right? Portions of the world that are under conflict, conflict zones, complex humanitarian emergencies. This kind of stuff is happening in real time constantly. But for us, it's few and far between, thankfully. And let's take a look at a potential scenario. So tropical storm, maybe it's a category one hurricane, sweeps up, hits New England on the south end, kind of skips, hops over New York City, goes up the Hudson River, bears slightly left in the Champlain Valley, and clobbers two-thirds of Vermont. All right? Unprecedented, uncommon, likely to happen with climate change, right? Remember, climate change has stacked the deck towards these types of atypical events. What we never would have thought of happening may come to pass more than we'd like to think in the next 50 to 100 years. So let's just say, and hopefully nobody's here from Copley, but let's say we throw down a hospital just down the road. So at the junction right in downtown Stowe, we build another critical access hospital. So a 25-bed facility, state-of-the-art construction. Maybe they didn't consult with all of the appropriate geological folks about where the floodplains were and were not. But here we are. So we're up here at Stowe, just down at the junction. And we know down in the Stowe Valley there, things flatten out a bit. And there are tributaries that flow right into town, basically. So let's just say, suspend your disbelief, we end up in a situation where we have a pretty powerful storm come through. And this storm goes ahead and drops 10 to 15 inches of rain. Unprecedented for Vermont. It doesn't mean it can't happen, though. And so we see more and more intense short-term rainfall events. Tropical storms often bring them. There are landslides. Maybe it was a bumpy summer, wet summer like we had during Irene. Water tables are high, ground saturated, landsliding. Maybe we've got some more pavement. All of this paints a picture of unprecedented flooding, a combination of flash flooding and inundation flooding. It's important to understand those two things and how they interact with each other. So where do we end up? Well, let's see. We did our best to kind of prepare the house, right? So we used our emergency management plan. It's a new hospital. Maybe they're not as well practiced, to Tom's point. And you know, they could only discharge so many, and they were in sort of hunker down mode. And they got themselves kind of locked in there as best they were able. They did evacuate some to a nearby nursing facility. They're left with, let's say, 20 beds full. So more than we'd like to see, right? If you're really kind of bracing, you're going to get rid of everybody you possibly can. That's a good example of a contingency standard. You would maybe expedite some discharges. Normally, these people will get hung on to for maybe one more night, and you're sending everybody home you can send home, assuming you can find a safe place for them to be. So we've got a combination of inundation and flash flooding. The last shift of your workers just barely makes it home before all the roads wash out in the area. We've got water washing out a bridge, which was recently rebuilt, and at the same time, second bridge on the Little River at the other end of West Hill Road is destroyed by flooding. At this point, the entire area of farmland, few homes are underwater, everything's kind of soaking wet. So what are the implications for you? Think through your emergency operations plan as you know it. How are you going to keep the doors open, lights on, taking care of people? Right? What's your contingency plan? What's your continuity of operations plan looks like? How are you getting information? Who are you talking to? How are you communicating with them? Are you tapped into the local emergency management system? So the town of Stowe has likely activated its emergency operations center. Do you know how to talk to them? Do they know how to talk to you? Have you been able to communicate your needs? What are your needs? All that fundamental out of the gates incident management stuff. So things worsen, as they will. So 2:30 in the morning on September 6th, conditions worsen, more catastrophic flooding occurring. There's only one road that was leading out of your immediate area, and it is gone now. Any vehicle access to the hospital is impossible. Surrounding areas under 9 inches of water. Electrical hazards during the flooding. Stowe Electric Department has shut off the power. The hospital has working generators on the rooftop and fuel, but the pumps supplying fuel from the underground storage tanks are located at the ground level, and the outside access door to the pump area did not get built to resist this type of flooding. So there was a breach, there was a failure, something went sideways. So they're about to lose their pump for the fuel, so even though the generators are in the right place, which we've learned from the experiences of other hospitals, they're still heading for trouble. When the Stowe Electric bursts up to power, the generators switch on, then shut down after a period of time. Maybe they ran for 50 minutes at a full load and ran out of fuel, the pump's not working, they're done. Hospital is now in darkness, with the exception of battery-powered emergency lighting that's in corridors, places like that. Does the hospital have a set of headlamps to cover every clinical area for staff? Don't know if you got that in the kit or not. If you do, you're deploying it. Hospital staff face the impossible responsibility to care for 14 patients without electricity. The hospital is now without the ability to do mechanical ventilation. Those have small battery packs, even the transport vents, they're not going to last long enough. They don't have power to run oxygen concentrators, suction units, Pyxis they're bypassing, they're going to key method to get at medications. Generally, most places are sort of cross-engineered to prevent that. Obviously, electronic medical records are down. All telecommunication down, unless they have sat phone, because cell phones are also down. Floors, generally the main floor, inundated with 9 inches of sticky, murky water. Split level construction took out about half of your usable space, basically, contaminated and or damaged. All of the staff and patients are packed into the upper level of the hospital. Staff are taking stock of supplies, taking a look at what they have and what they need. They're trying to connect with state resources. Again, we do have robust layers of response for state support, but it's not instantaneous. So things really got away from him in this scenario. Again, what are the kind of priorities here? And what are the needs? And what can they match against the resources on hand? So what do they have on hand in terms of resources? People, some equipment, maybe less than they would like, but do they have manual alternatives? So again, that idea of substitution. Food and water, presumably they have some at least. So things are really bad. Some people in this scenario are likely not to survive no matter what you do. No outside help is immediately going to get there to save the day. Even in a place like Vermont, that can happen. 2/3 of the state got hit by this storm. There's no easy decision making. So this gets us to the kind of principles at this point of how are we going to turn to this crisis standards of care plan and what can we do to kind of make some decisions. So we've been talking through the ethical backdrop on some of this as well. And so one of the things to do is look within your own walls and talk to your teams about the kind of combination of your organizational mission against a set of ethics when sort of the chips are down. So what are the shared organizational values and can they be sort of leveraged in this crisis standards framework to go ahead and make the tough decisions that may need to be made? Based on what you heard today already, I mean, what are your thoughts in terms of where this might take you? You've gotten a kernel full of information about how to kind of contend with this, but what would you do right now if confronting this type of scenario? It's sort of unthinkable in some ways, but trying to provoke you to that level. What do you think? What's the sort of appropriate moves here? Yeah.
Well, certainly your staffing, if you've got one shift who's gonna tire out pretty quickly, ability to deliver your other personnel to the location by boat or, helicopter, whatever, people.
Yep, getting people. Keeping the people you have, taking care of them, is there food, water, shelter for them? Do you have a modified schedule for rest breaks, intervals to get people some downtime? Have you by now changed your staffing ratios, right? Is it one nurse overseeing 10 patients? You just don't know what you're gonna have to work with. But yeah, think about every trick in your bag and potentially deploy it. What else?
Ryan? I'm just gonna add to this. So there's still heart attacks. In fact, there's more heart attacks now going on in your community because everybody's stressed. There's carbon monoxide poisoning because people are running their generators in their garages. People are still cutting themselves. They're still needing care. They're still showing up at your door and you're a hospital and you have an emergency department and it has to keep running.
Diversion if you can do it. Maybe the hospital is inaccessible. If the hospital is truly inaccessible, you will have less traffic, but not none. People in Vermont have boats. They're paddling right up to the emergency department. You have a big sign in the front that says closed. Doesn't matter. They're going to show up anyways. So how are you going to do a modified kind of catcher's mitt for that group of people that want to come there? So anchoring it back, these are some of the anchors of the crisis standards framework. And how do we apply these, you know, just simple words to what we're actually trying to do? This notion of duty to care we haven't even really touched on. Can you just simply close and walk away? What type of healthcare outlet are you? If you're a Vermont hospital, an acute care hospital, probably not an option for you, right? And often you're the healthcare outlet of last resort. But there's a duty here, and I think you would find most healthcare workers are gonna do their absolute best. For me, when I think about this in the context of Vermont, there's this strong Yankee ingenuity backdrop, right? There's so many things, we just get it done by kind of winging it, and we get through it just fine. Irene is a great example. But this is one area where we want to have a bit of forethought and apply some pre-planning, in a sense, even if it remains a little fuzzier. Then, you know, we're like, you want something a little more granular? We're not going to give it to you. It's going to stay a little fuzzy, but at least we're having the conversation. So you need to have that conversation with your nursing staff, with your medical staff, and really try to unpack as many pieces and parts as you can. So maximizing survival, minimize adverse outcomes. The opposites will happen. There will be bad outcomes and people will die in some of these scenarios. And you're trying to do the greatest good for the greatest number while protecting your staff and your people. Another hard thing to wrap your head around, go back to that pandemic scenario. Your hospital and your healthcare system may become inundated by your own people. You have your staff caring for staff who fall ill in scenarios like that. Or the people in this scenario, their homes are flooded. Their 8-year-old is missing because he fell into the floodwaters. I mean, all of those things are happening in the background, running in the background as you try to wrestle with these macro decisions at the hospital level. We wanted to provide you a couple links. I believe Vaz is going to have these slides available. Is that? Yep, Emma, thanks. So these links will be here for you. I wanted to show you a couple examples of it. So the state health department will have a portal set up. There is one now also on the vendor's website, the contractor we used. To provide feedback on the draft plan. And so again, just go to the portion of the health department's website dedicated to emergency preparedness, you'll find it. There's also gonna be a link to a webinar. I don't know if you mentioned that earlier. So there was a version of this presentation recorded on a webinar. So you can distribute that to your teams and give them like the little sort of thimbleful. This is a great resource set. So the Department of Health and Human Services in their kind of emergency preparedness world at the federal level has an online, essentially, database compendium of all kinds of good resources. Everything from academic journal articles on this topic to planning guidance to the Minnesota materials we've also incorporated in our plan. So the site is called Asper Tracy, Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response, but Tracy is this web portal that's free and open, and you can get right in there and read a bunch of this background content. And then, as was already mentioned today, there's an author named Sherry Fink who's done a lot of work on this topic coming out of Katrina. So you can buy her book, or you could go the free route, and there's still, you can read her original article on ProPublica that she wrote, that I think the Times also picked up parts of back there. So we're out of time. We do want to thank you for coming to this. This is really one of the first forays to put it in front of a broader audience. Any thoughts or comments you have, please come up and see us afterwards. We really are completely open to it. It is a draft plan. It is a squishy framework, and we really want to see it kind of to continue to rise up, and as Ryan said, I think our size here can benefit us, and we can do this well as a state. And we've got, you know, 14 acute care hospitals well connected and stitched together. So, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.